A short series of lessons concerning discernment and decisions. And I don't want to overstate my case about the importance of discernment, but in some ways it appears that when the Old Testament law was replaced by the gospel, that the role of discernment became more important than ever. For example, in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus focused more on the heart and the inner person than on the mere outward actions. Under the old law, the commandment was, you shall not kill, you shall not murder. All the Israelite had to do in regards to that commandment was to ask himself if he had murdered anyone. Had he taken someone's life? Jesus said that it was just as important, if not more important, to examine your attitude towards the person. Not much discernment was needed to figure out if you had murdered someone. But evaluating your anger or your hate towards a person was a matter of profound discernment. Adultery is the same way. We generally know if we have committed physical adultery or not. But Christian men probably struggle often with evaluating their thoughts about various women in various situations. Discernment takes us deeper than looking only at outward physical actions. This also works in positive commands. On various occasions, the Israelites had to offer specific sacrifices. It was fairly easy to determine if the sacrifice had been offered or not. But Paul wrote in Romans chapter 12, verse 2, that we should offer our bodies as living sacrifices, holy and acceptable to God. It takes some honest introspection to determine if we have done that or not. And in fact, it is an ongoing evaluation process. If an Old Testament sacrifice had been offered, it became a historical fact. It had happened. Offering our lives to God as living sacrifices, though, is a daily ongoing process. It's much more than a done once and for all type thing. Good discernment takes effort. Takes practice. We saw that last Sunday morning when we looked at Hebrews chapter 5, verse 14. Lack of discernment sort of gives us a free pass to live life our way instead of God's way. But misguided discernment can make us feel like lousy, weak Christians when that's not necessarily the case. It's true that we are never good enough to deserve salvation, but it is also true that even without total perfection, we can live lives that please God. Discernment plays a major role in that kind of living. Last week we looked at some passages that show the important role of discernment in a variety of situations. This morning, I want to look at some specific examples of people who discerned or didn't. As is often the case, there are many stories in the Old Testament that provide a wealth of examples for us to use. We'll look at one case where good discernment was applied. We'll look at a case where it wasn't. It was poor discernment, if any. And we'll look at a man who almost went one way, but by discernment went the other way. We'll also look at some New Testament passages that can be obeyed only by discernment. These are cases where faithful living calls for more than keeping a direct command. In a sense, or at least in some cases, discernment is what helps us obey not only the letter of a doctrine, but the spirit of it as well. If nothing else, we'll see that growing in discernment is a vital element in becoming mature Christians. So we're going to look at these three Old Testament stories, one with good discernment, one with poor discernment, and one that wavered at least at first. In Numbers chapters 13 and 14, we have the famous story of the Israelites sending the spies to check out the promised land. They had successfully come out of Egypt, crossed the Red Sea with the waters impressively piled up on either side of them. They had received the law in the amazing series of events at Mount Sinai with smoke and noise on the mountain and the voice of God and all kinds of tremendously impressive things. Then the Lord instructed Moses to send spies to check out the promised land. The goal was probably to convince the Israelites that the promised land was every bit as desirable as they had been told. And this positive report would then motivate the people to go forward with a lot of positive energy. So one spy was chosen from each of the 12 tribes, and the spies then spent 40 days exploring the promised land. They saw that it was an extremely attractive place to live. They even brought back samples of the produce. For example, they brought back a single cluster of grapes that was so big that they had to carry it on a pole suspended on the shoulders of two men. That's a big clump of grapes. They also saw that there were some fortified cities that, once they had been conquered, would provide protection for the Israelites who would be able to live in these cities without having to go to the bother of building the fortifications themselves. On the downside, they first had to conquer those fortified cities. And they saw that some of the people living in those cities were quite powerful. There were even some giants, some Goliath types, that they would have to fight against. And you know the story from there. 10 of the spies were overwhelmed by the idea of fighting against giants in walled cities, regardless of how big the grapes were. 2 spies, Joshua and Caleb, thought otherwise. Their viewpoint was that the Canaanites were indeed powerful, but their God was even more powerful. And we see several instances of discernment as we go through the story. First, there's the discernment of the spies themselves, where 10 of them considered only the physical elements and forgot to factor in God's role. The general population followed that same line of thought. But Joshua and Caleb discerned that with God on their side, victory was theirs. But Joshua and Caleb also showed discernment in their resolve. Not only did they go against the opinion of the other 10 spies in their report, but as the report was given and received, they also saw popular opinion go against them. At one point in Numbers 14, verse 11, the mob was ready to stone to death Joshua and Caleb because of the approach they took. The 2 men considered the opinion of the other 10, they considered the opinion of the multitude, and they considered what they believed about God. In the end, the major problem wasn't how dangerous the Canaanites were. For Joshua and Caleb, the real danger was the angry mob of Israelites. They considered their options, and guided by faith, they discerned that regardless of what the majority wanted, they would trust God regardless of the outcome. You probably know the story well, so I'm not telling you anything that you don't already know. But most of the time, we look at the decision of Joshua and Caleb and consider it almost entirely as a matter of faith. And faith is certainly a central feature. Don't want to downplay the importance of faith in their response. But their faith was implemented by discernment. And that discernment resulted in these 2 men being the only 2 men out of probably 2 million Israelites who pleased God by their decision and by their actions. In 1 Kings chapter 12, Solomon had died, and his son Rehoboam became king. Solomon had been a builder. He had built the temple of God. He had built a palace for himself. He had built palaces for various ones of his wives. He had built fortified cities throughout the land. All of that building was expensive. And so he had taxed the Israelites to pay for the building projects and also conscripted workers for the building projects. But now the major building projects were completed. The nation was at peace, had no ongoing wars against any of their neighbors or enemies, so the need for heavy taxation was less, and the need for a large building force was less. So the people asked that the new king, Rehoboam, would lighten their burden of taxes and forced labor. As the new king, lacking experience, Rehoboam appeared that he was going to do the right thing. He first called in the older counselors, those who had advised his father Solomon, and asked their advice. They encouraged him to grant the people's request, and in return he would be rewarded by their gratitude and loyal service. But then he asked the advice of his friends who had no more experience or wisdom than he did. They encouraged him to make a show of force and of power. He could show the people who was really boss now if he was an even more demanding king than his father Solomon had been. The question was between more taxes or lower taxes. Actually, the question was, what kind of king would Rehoboam be? There was no direct command in the law that said to listen to the older men and lower taxes. This was a matter of discernment. He needed to think it through and then do what was best for the kingdom. Rehoboam lacked discernment, and as a result, the kingdom was split in two and would be a divided kingdom until both branches had been defeated by outside enemies. In 2 Kings chapter 5, we have the story of Naaman. Naaman was a high-ranking Syrian army official who had leprosy. He also had a servant girl who had been captured in raids down in Israel. She told him about an Israelite prophet in Samaria who could heal lepers. So he headed to Samaria to look for the prophet. He eventually found himself standing in front of the house of Elisha, where he expected to be received with a proper show of respect for such a high-ranking Syrian official. But instead, Elisha didn't even go out to meet him in person. He sent a servant out to tell Naaman to go wash himself 7 times in the Jordan River, and he would be healed of his leprosy. Naaman took affront at the lack of respect shown to him, and he didn't see why washing in the Jordan would work any better than washing in the bigger and better rivers of Syria. So he headed home quite miffed. But then his servants encouraged him to think it through a little more. Maybe he was right, and the water and the rivers of Syria were just as good, if not better, than the Jordan. But what did he have to lose by doing what Elisha had told him to do? Discernment would help him overcome his pride that Elisha had offended. Discernment would give the prophet's instructions a try. So he washed 7 times in the Jordan, and his leprosy disappeared. A little discernment made the difference. With Naaman, we can't even say there was faith involved. He didn't believe what Elisha told him, but by discernment, he did the right thing. In each of these three stories, the key characters possessed the information they needed. The spies knew what God had done for Israel, and they knew what they had found in their exploration of Canaan. Rehoboam heard the advice of one group, he heard the advice of the other group, and he knew the history of his father's time as king. Naaman knew what Elisha said he should do in order to be healed. In each case, they had the information. The good or bad outcome was determined by discerning, by thinking it through and making the decision that would line them up with the will of God. Much of the New Testament is written to people who were already Christians. Much of the time, what was being written to them was not new information for them at the time it was written. It may have been new to us the first time we read the various letters of Paul or Peter or John or the others, but the people to whom they were writing had received their basic instruction in most cases from the people who had converted them. Best example we have is in Acts chapter 2, Jerusalem, day of Pentecost. 3,000 converts were then taught, even post-baptism, by the apostles who had taught them the gospel in the first place. So quite often, the letters written to the churches were reminders or clarifications of things they had already been taught, or they were exhortations to the readers to apply things they had already been taught. In many cases, the basic message was, you have the information, now think about it. Discern what that means in how you live. Paul's three major letters, at least by size and in some cases by the depth of the doctrine, are Romans, 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians. 16 times in these three letters, Paul asked a rhetorical question designed to encourage discernment about things the readers already knew. The key phrase is, do you not know? And each time the implication is that they indeed did know, but Paul is calling them to discern the implications of what they already knew. Maybe the best known do you not know passage is Romans 6. In Romans 6, someone was teaching that since we are saved by grace, it doesn't matter if we sin or not, because that just gives God an opportunity to show more grace. Paul responds in Romans 6, verse 3, by asking, do you not know? Romans 6, verse 3. Or do you not know that as many of us as were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore, we were buried with him through baptism, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. The point was that they had been joined with Christ when they were baptized. They knew that. There was no doubt about that. Paul wasn't writing to provide that as a new revelation to them. He was writing to call them to think about, to discern what it meant in everyday life to have been joined with Christ in baptism. He then adds down in verse 6 that knowing this, we have been set free from sin. Verses 6 and 7, knowing this, that our old man was crucified with him, that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves of sin. For he who has died has been freed from sin. Now discern. If they were no longer slaves to sin, quit sinning. That's what discernment would teach you. Their problem wasn't a lack of information about the sacrifice of Christ. Their problem was a lack of discernment about a forgiven person's relationship with sin and with Christ. Paul used the do you not know device frequently in 1 Corinthians, especially in chapters 5 and 6. In chapter 5, 1 Corinthians chapter 5, he is dealing with the case of a Christian man who was living in adultery with his stepmother. The church had taken a hands-off approach on the assumption that his private sin wasn't their problem. So in 1 Corinthians 5, verse 6, he says, do you not know that a little leaven leavens the whole lump? Your glorying is not good. Do you not know that a little leaven leavens the whole lump? The message was that they knew this basic proverb, but they weren't discerning what it meant in the body of Christ. Following chapter, in chapter 6, he addresses the issue of Christians suing each other in the Roman court system. It was a horrible situation that Christians couldn't resolve their problems without going to courts run by unbelievers. So he says, do you not know? 1 Corinthians 6, verse 3. Do you not know that we shall judge angels? How much more things that pertain to this life? If Christians are going to judge angels, surely they could sort out a few personal disputes. And then he adds down in verse 5, that surely they could find one Christian man who could discern in these situations. 1 Corinthians 6, 5, I say this to your shame. Is it so that there is not a wise man among you, not even one, who will be able to judge between his brethren? Remember that judge is one of that group of words that are practically synonymous with discern. Surely there's someone among you who can discern these things. The second part of chapter 6 is about sexual immorality. Somehow, someone was thinking that it wasn't adultery if a Christian man went to prostitutes. And I suppose it is possible that they had been taught that adultery is wrong, but they hadn't been taught that this specific type of behavior, this specific kind of adultery, was indeed adultery. And so they put it in a separate category or something. But Paul says, do you not know? Meaning, can't you figure this out? 1 Corinthians 6, verse 15. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ? Shall I then take the members of Christ and make them members of a harlot? Certainly not. Or do you not know that he who is joined to a harlot is one body with her? They had received general teachings that by discernment they should have been able to apply to various situations, even if all of those situations hadn't been pinpointed in the teaching they had received. Later in 1 Corinthians, chapter 10, Paul dealt with another matter that called for discernment. In chapter 10, he addresses the issue of eating foods that had been offered to idols. It was a complicated problem for them. It was a complicated issue. Some Christians wouldn't touch those foods because they didn't want to have any connection with idolatry, not even indirectly. Others didn't want to participate in idolatry, but in their mind, food is food. So if they personally didn't think of this as being a sacrifice to an idol, they could go ahead and treat it as ordinary food and they could eat it. And there were some solid points to be made on either side of the question. So Paul conceded that technically, maybe a person could eat these sacrifice foods as nothing but ordinary food. But there was another thing to consider. Even if it wasn't inherently sinful to eat such food, a Christian should also consider what his example would do to another Christian who couldn't separate in his mind the food from the idolatrous practices. 1 Corinthians 10, verses 23-24. All things are lawful for me, but not all things are helpful. All things are lawful for me, but not all things edify. Let no one seek his own, but each one the other's well-being. He's saying that some things are lawful, meaning that they are not necessarily sins, but they're not helpful. They don't build up, they don't edify Christian behavior. How can we tell what is lawful but isn't helpful or doesn't edify. Discernment. He's calling them to think it through and think about the impact on the faith of other Christians. In the Bible, we have God's revealed word for us. The Bible covers centuries of history, covers all kinds of situations, describes people with a variety of personalities, a variety of talents, a variety of weaknesses. Even then, it does not and cannot deal directly and specifically with every situation that might come up. In those cases, we have to take what God has said and use discernment to apply His Word in various situations. We have to think. We have to discern. And we're very aware of the need to be discerning in many settings. For example, we know that in what we generally call the world, many things are promoted as good that are totally unacceptable for Christians. We're very alert when it's the world versus us. And if sometimes these things aren't obvious, we still have our antennas up to distinguish between the world's way and God's way. We might be a bit more careless, though, with the trends and messages of the religious and even of the Christian world. I'll just mention one example because it touches us so often, but just one area as an example. The entire domain of religious media has been totally commercialized. Christian books, Christian music, even Bibles are published primarily for profit. Why do we have a single woman study Bible, a Christian athlete study Bible, a Spirit-filled life study Bible, an abundant life study Bible, and a life in the Spirit study Bible, plus dozens of others? Because a wide variety of slightly tweaked presentations sells more product. Now, that doesn't mean that every Christian song is evil and that every Christian book is unscriptural. It just means that marketing and profit drive the product. It means that faithful Christians must always use discernment. Just because a writer, a well-known writer, comes up with 10 steps to be a great Christian husband doesn't mean that all 10 steps are required or even supported by Scripture. But who's going to figure it out? It has to be discerning Christians. And it helps if the discerning Christian is surrounded by a spiritual family of discerning Christians. Phil read for us a passage earlier from the early part of Colossians 2. We're going to close with a similar statement drawn from Ephesians chapter 4, where Paul writes that we should no longer be children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine, by the trickery of men, in the cunning craftiness by which they lie in wait to deceive, but speaking the truth in love, may grow up in all things into Him who is the head, Christ. Calls for discernment. One person may tell you that you can be saved one way, another may tell you something different. Each of those teachers will be held responsible for what he or she has taught. But you and I will be saved based on what we believe and what we do or don't do based on what we believe. Our personal discernment of the Bible and what it says is critical to our relationship with God. We won't be saved by what someone else believes, and we won't be lost by what someone else believes. We must each believe in Christ, repent of our sins, be baptized for the forgiveness of those sins. If that's what you want to do this morning, do it and don't let anyone hold you back. And if you need the church to help you defeat sin, to help you live more faithfully, to help you discern better, we are here to help and want to do that. If you want to respond this morning, let us know. Let's stand. Let's sing.